Facebook friends and brothers and sisters in Christ that are come to worship with us on Sunday morning. And if you'll grab the hymnal there in front of you, I apologize for words not being on the screen. Our person that does that is off. So the hymnal is right under the seat in front of you if you want to put the hymnal. And it's page 693. Page 693.
The Lord's our rock, in Him we hide, shelter in the time of storm. Secure whatever ill betide, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter. Time of
page number 693.
A shade by day, defense by night, a shelter in the time of storm. No fears alarm, no foes affright, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. The raging storms may round us beat, a shelter in the time of storm. We'll never leave our safe retreat, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, rock divine, oh, refuge dear, a shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our helper ever near, a shelter in the time of storm. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. Oh, Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in the time of storm.
And if you'll turn to page 772. We talk about when we all get to heaven.
Yes, sir.
Looking forward to that.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansion, bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. Should we say, days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
And while the piano plays, would you greet your neighbor?
Thank you. then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
And you may be seated.
All right, good morning, Canyon Springs. I said good morning, Canyon Springs. Oh, you are alive this morning. All right, that's a good thing. We're going to give you some announcements this morning. Don't forget, on October the 30th, we have our Harvest Sunday, our trunk and treat for our young people. And that is also our anniversary day. We will be 37 years old on the 30th of October, so that's a good thing. Ladies' Bible study is in their third or fourth week. They're in their third. How many fingers you got up? Three. Okay, they're in their third week, and that is on Thursday nights in the fellowship hall at 6:30 p.m. So, ladies, avail yourself of that option. That's a good thing. That's in the fellowship hall. Continue to pray for Preacher and his wife. They are on sabbatical. They are somewhere, I believe, in Arizona. Is that right? They're somewhere in Arizona, and we're not going to tell you where they are because we don't want you to visit them. They're having a nice time. And pray for them for rest and relaxation. The Lord would bring them back to us safely.
Amen.
And since I'm standing here, I'm going to plug 9:30 Bible study. We have a Bible study at 9:30.
Who leads it?
Some guy named Marcone. I don't know. Anyway, 9:30. We just started a new series this morning on what happens when a person believes on Christ. 40 different things happen to a person when he believes on Christ. So you got some good notes this morning. Try and make it 9:30 on Sunday morning. All right. We have a birthday. Is that right?
We do.
Okay. We got a birthday. Whose birthday is it?
Joyce Demeline.
Oh, you're not. It's not a secret?
No.
Oh, it's not a secret. Okay.
She told me she's as old as the church, 37.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joyce. Happy birthday to you.
If you stand with me, please, grab your hymnals. Turn to page number 696. 696. It just tells us what God does. He just leads us along. We just got to be smart enough to follow.
In shady green pastures so rich and so sweet, God leads His dear children along. Where the water's cool flow flows up everyone's feet, God leads His dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. Sometimes on the mount where the sun shone so bright, God leads His dear Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. Though sorrows befall us and Satan opposed, God leads His dear children along. Through days we can conquer, defeat our love foes. God leads His dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long.
And you may be seated.
Amen. All right. God leads His dear children,
yes, He does,
along. Amen. All right. At this time, we will have our children's church. Sister Joyce will take some children, if they are willing, to go over to Junior Church in the Fellowship Hall. So hope that that occurs. And I want you to turn to the book of Matthew and pick up Matthew chapter 13, if you would. Here is our scripture reading for this morning, Matthew chapter 13. We're going to read the first nine verses, Matthew chapter 13, verse 1. The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside. And a great multitude were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning. We pray, Lord, that exactly as your word says, we would this morning have ears to hear. We would have ears to hear. Help us, Lord, to understand what your word says this morning. Bless our preacher as he brings the word to us. May he do so with simplicity and godly sincerity. And Lord, may we truly have ears to hear. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name, for Jesus' sake. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a special. Charlotte will play for us.
Where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me, to walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death shall be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, see that it was worth it.
All right, it's working now. Amen. I don't really need a, I really don't need a microphone, but thank you anyway. Amen. All right, let me move this stuff. I appreciate Brother Joe's prayer just a few minutes ago when he prayed, may the sermon be given with simplicity, because we're going to deal with a sermon this morning that is not simple in itself. And so I pray the Lord will help me to make these truths plain to you. As Brother Wirtz is gone for most of the month of October, he's asked me to fill in for him on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights. And I've been praying for an opportunity to bring a series of messages on Matthew chapter 13. Matthew 13 is the parables of the kingdom. And we're going to cover these parables in the weeks, in the Sundays that are before us. But you look at, there's 58 verses in Matthew 13. So I could not preach it all to you in just one sermon. I could, but you wouldn't want it. And so we're going to just kind of give an introductory, going to give an introduction this morning. Before I get into the introduction, turn your Bible, please, to Matthew 13. There's one thing, a couple of things that I need to mention. First of all, the men's coffee hour on Saturday. I thought Brother Joe would plug it because he what's that? Friday. It's Friday at 6, at 8 o'clock. And they're going through the book of Exodus. I think it's Exodus 36. Exodus 36. That's a great chapter. I was reading it this morning. And that's where God had to tell the people of Israel not to give so much. You'd like to hear that, wouldn't you? Amen. And so anyway, Matthew, Exodus 36, this Friday at 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, okay. One other thing I want to mention is October is Pastor Appreciation Month. Pastor, you can cuss them out 11 months out of the year, but on October you say nothing but good about them. No, I'm just kidding. I want to wonder about, like, Thanksgiving. Like, you can gripe and complain 364 days out of the year, but on Thanksgiving you need to be thankful. I think you need to be thankful every day, amen?
Amen.
And you ought to appreciate your pastor every day.
Amen.
However, what you should do this month, I know it means a lot to Brother Wirtz, is if you go to a Hallmark card or someplace that sells greeting cards, or just write a note to him saying, Pastor, I appreciate you. And that'll mean a lot to him. Amen. So at least send him a note, write a handwriting, or just get him a card or send him a text or something that, Pastor, I appreciate you on Pastor Appreciation Month, October. When I was pastoring in Port Orchard, Washington, I had two people that every October they would give me a card, Pastor Appreciate. I forgot all about it myself, and I wouldn't have remembered it unless they told me that. So, yes.
If they would put them in the offering box, we'd put them on his desk.
That'd be a good idea. So if you get a card or a note or anything, just put it in the offering box and drop it in with your offering, and they'll put it on his desk. Drop in whether you have an offering or not. But, you know, there's other ways. You can give online through the online thing. There's the mention of that in the bulletin there. Okay, Matthew chapter number 13. Look at verse number 3. I know Brother Joe read all 9 verses, and tonight we're going to deal with the parable of the sower. But I want you to look at verse 3 very carefully, 13:3. And he spake many things unto them in what?
Parables.
That's the first time you have the word parable mentioned in the New Testament. It's right here. So you might put first mention there. Now, Herbert Lockyer, who is a great author, he's written books, All the Men in the Bible and All the Women in the Bible and All the Prayers in the Bible and All the Promises in the Bible. That's a great set of books. He's also got a book called All the Parables in the Bible. And he counts 250 parables, Old and New Testament. Now, I haven't made sure that he's right on that. I haven't counted them, but I know in the New Testament, this is the first time that you have the word parable mentioned. And somebody said that a parable is simply an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. That's a simple definition. An earthly story, something that takes place on earth, but it's getting a heavenly or a spiritual meaning across. It's a story that will illustrate a doctrine or a precept. And so when you come to parables, you want to observe certain things, certain rules that you need to keep in mind. Let me give you just a few of those rules that you should follow when you're studying parables, since we're going to be studying parables for the next few weeks. Number one, parables are usually identified as a parable. Jesus says he spake a parable unto them. Look at verse number 18 for man, chapter 13, verse 18. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. So he very plainly says that this is a parable he is speaking. Go to chapter 21, Matthew 21, and verse 33. We're going to look at all of them, but 21:33. Okay. And another parable. There was a certain householder. So it usually he'll preface a parable by saying, this is a parable. So there's no doubt about it. Sometimes what some people call parables are not really parables at all. They are mainly metaphors or similes or some type of a figure of speech. So parables are stories that are used to illustrate a particular truth. Another thing you need to keep in mind is New Testament parables. I'm talking about the parables you find in the New Testament. New Testament parables never use a proper name. For example, go to Luke chapter 16. Keep your place in Matthew 13, but go to Luke chapter 16. And this is a favorite of the liberals and the no-hellers and the Jehovah Witnesses and anybody that doesn't believe in hell. And of course, we know the passage. Luke 16 verses 19 to 31 is a story of the rich man and Lazarus and how he's talking about hell here. It says, in hell he lifted up his eyes being in torment, and there's flames and so forth. So, but we know it's not a parable, although people say it might be a parable. It's not a parable. And the reason we know it's not a parable is because it uses proper names. Look at verse 20. Do you see a proper name in verse 20? Yeah, Lazarus. Go to verse 22. Verse 22. You see a proper name there? Abraham. So you go on through here, and so talk about Abraham and Lazarus. So we know this is not a parable because it does use proper names. Now, the first Bible I ever bought with my own money was a Schofield Reference Bible, and that was a great Bible. But if you go to Luke chapter 10. And if you have a Schofield Bible, don't throw it away. It's a good Bible. There's more in it that'll bless you than hurt you. But here's one place where Dr. Schofield made a mistake. How many have a Schofield Bible in your hands? Okay, so if you go to verse 30, and before verse 30, Luke chapter 10, verse 30, it says, the parable of the Good Samaritan. How many see that in their Bible? A parable of the Good Samaritan. Okay, that's wrong. Just put this, it's not even a parable. You know how I know? Because number one, it doesn't say it's a parable. And number two, it uses proper names throughout this thing. For example, look at verse number 30. Let's see, verse 30. Do you see a proper name in verse 30? Yeah, a couple. Jerusalem and Jericho and so forth. You go on down. Verse 32. Likewise, a Levite. That's a proper name. So you go down through here. So the good Samaritan is not a parable, despite what Dr. Schofield says, or anybody else that has a parable of the Good Samaritan. That's not a parable. That is a real story. This is a real happening. It actually happened. Another thing you need to keep in mind about a parable is a parable will either clarify a truth or it will conceal a truth. It'll clarify a truth to anybody who's receptive to it, who wants the truth. And it'll clarify that truth for them, or It'll hide that truth from those who don't want the truth. You don't want it? God says, okay, I won't give it to you. And, for example, go back to Matthew 13. Look at verse number 10. Very interesting question here. So, the disciples, they hear this parable, and then in verse 10 it says, "And the disciples came and said unto him, Why speakest thou unto them in parables?" Why are you talking about parables here? What difference does it make? And then he answers the question, and we won't read, take time to read it, but verse number 17, he goes down from verse 11 down to verse 17 and says, "For verily I say unto you that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which you see and have not seen them, and hear those things which you hear and have not heard them." The reason they didn't hear it because they weren't open to the truth. They didn't want the truth. They heard the parable, interesting story, but they didn't want it. They didn't want the truth that Jesus was trying to convey there. So it was hidden from them. We'll talk more about that as we go. So as I said, Jesus spoke, it depends on what you call a parable, but about 20 parables that he says he spake a parable unto them. So we know these are parables. Let me just give you the list here, and you don't have to write these down, but these are some of the parables that are definitely called parables in Jesus' teaching. The barren fig tree, the budded fig tree, the divided kingdom, the humbled guest, the householder's vineyard. Go to Luke chapter 15 for a minute. I'll show you this one. Luke chapter number 15. This is a parable you all know. At least you ought to know it. Luke 15. Look at verse 3. Luke 15, verse 3. "And he spake this parable unto them, saying," comma. So there's one parable. It doesn't say he spake these parables unto them. It's one parable. And the parable consists of a lost sheep, of a lost piece of silver, and a lost son. And the prodigal son's is in there, and the lost silver that the woman sweeps her house trying to find. And all, of course, the lost sheep that the shepherd goes out until he finds it. So that's one parable, and that one parable is three parts. We call it a triune parable, but it's one parable. The parable of the lost sheep, the lost silver, and the lost son. There's also in Matthew chapter 22, there's the parable of the marriage feast. There's the parable of the new cloth. In Luke chapter 18, there's the parable of the Pharisee and the publican. You all know that one. There's the parable of the rich fool. There's the parable of the 10 pounds. There's the parable of the unjust judge. And then there's the parable of the wise steward. So those are some of the basic parables that Jesus taught. However, when we get to Matthew 13, where the word parable first shows up, we have the parables of the kingdom. And he starts off, verse 3, "And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying," he's going to give a parable here, "Behold, a sower went forth to sow," and Brother Joe just read that passage. So we have the parable of the sower. Then you go on down a little bit farther, verse number 24, another parable he's put forth to them, and he talks about the parable of the tares among the wheat. Then in verse 31, another parable he put forth to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like unto a grain of mustard seed," the mustard seed parable. And then in verse 33, the parable of the leaven. And then verse 44, the parable of the hidden treasure. In verse 45 and 46, you have the parable of the pearl of great price. And finally, he sums up these seven parables using the parable of the dragnet. Look at verse 47. "And again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered gathered of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good unto the vessels, but cast the bad away. So shall it be in the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire, and there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. So that's the now in verse 51 down to verse 53. Some people classify this one as a parable. It's more of an exhortation or an application of what he just said. Look at verse 51. And Jesus said unto them, have ye understood all these things? And they say unto him, yea, Lord. Then he said unto them, and a lot of people use verse 52 as another parable, but I don't call it a parable. Therefore, every scribe which is instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like, he's like, it's a simile, it's like unto a man that is a householder, which bringeth forth of out of his treasure things new and old. And it came to pass that when he had finished these parables, he departed thence. So you have seven, maybe eight, if you consider this last one a parable, that are listed here in Matthew chapter number 13. Now, it's important when you read your Bible, it's important for you to understand what the Bible is all about. It has always been God's plan to establish his kingdom on the earth. I mean, that was his plan right from Adam and Eve, right on through to Revelation, where the kingdom is realized. So it's always been God's plan to establish kingdom. So when you read the Bible, you're reading about kings, you're reading about thrones, you're reading about kingdoms. As a matter of fact, I haven't counted them, but I have a Bible program, and I studied this form. Some form of the words king or kingdoms occur 3,274 times in your King James Bible. 3,274 times. So, you just study those things out. It's obvious that the Bible is about a king or kingdoms and God's desire to establish a king and desire a kingdom on earth. And that's how the whole Bible ends up in the book of Revelation. But the thing about a kingdom is you can't have a king. You can't have a kingdom without a king. Obviously, if you're talking about a kingdom, then you have to have a king. And the Lord Jesus Christ is God's king. But Israel rejected Jesus as king. We will not have this man to reign over us. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. They did not want that. When Jesus was brought forth by Pontius Pilate to the crowd, they said, we have no king but Caesar. So they rejected Jesus as their king. So when you come to Matthew 13, it's very important that you see the context. The context in which Matthew 13 originates. Now, you can write these things down if you want, but let me give you the events that lead up to chapter 13. So in Matthew chapter 1 to chapter 4, you have Jesus presented as the king. He's presented as the king in those first four chapters. And then in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, he lays down the principles of the kingdom. That's in the Sermon on the Mount. But then in chapter 8 through chapter 10, this is the miracle chapter. Jesus performs many miracles proving his credentials as the king. For example, go back to Matthew chapter 8 for a minute. Let me just show you some of these. And you could read these on your own, but you read miracle after miracle after miracle in Matthew chapter 8. 9 and 10. For example, chapter 8, verse 3. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. So you have the cleansing of the leper there. That's a miracle. Verse 13. Go to verse 13. And Jesus said unto the centurion, go thy way, as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And his servant was healed the same hour. So in chapter 8, verse 13, you have another miracle. Verse 15. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto him. So there's another miracle in chapter 8, verse 15. And so you could go through this whole section here from chapter 8, 9, and 10. You'll find miracle after miracle after miracle. Why was Jesus performing these miracles? To prove who he was. He was the king. He was the king. But it is also becoming increasingly apparent that the Jews were rejecting Jesus as king. They were rejecting his kingdom. And so if you go to chapter 11, you don't see very many miracles after chapter 11. There's a couple, but notice in verse 11, verse 20. 11:20. Then began he to upright their cities, wherein most of his mighty works were done, most of these miracles were done, because they repented not. So we see here that there is an unrepentant attitude. Matter of fact, go to chapter 12 and look at verse 14. Chapter 12, Matthew 12, verse 14. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council together, held a council against him, how they might what? They want to kill him. They want to kill him. So, I mean, you see this. He's presented as king in the first four chapters of Matthew. Then he gives the principles of the kingdom in chapters 5, 6, and 7. And then he does these miracles in chapters 10 and 8, 9, and 10. But then in chapter 11, you see they begin to resist him as king. And finally they say, we got to get rid of this guy. We got to kill him. Look at verse 14 again. Matthew 12, verse 14. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him, period. But look at verse 15. But when Jesus knew it, what did he do? He withdrew. He withdrew himself from thence. He left. And from there, that was the official rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ. You go to chapter 12 and you read a little bit further here. You see that they actually commit the unpardonable sin in verses 22 to 32. We're not going to talk about the unpardonable sin, but they committed that. So they rejected Jesus as king. So upon the rejection of Jesus as king, that offer of the kingdom was withdrawn. It was withdrawn, but it was not abandoned. God is still going to set up a kingdom on this earth. Amen. But the offer of the kingdom was withdrawn from the nation of Israel. And then, but it would be reinstated later in the Bible. Now, let me give you a little bit of scenario here. What might have happened if, and that's a big if Israel accepted Jesus as their king, they could have had the kingdom right then at that time. But they rejected Christ and the kingdom. And so the kingdom was hidden away with their king. And so during this period of time, when this kingdom is withdrawn, the kingdom takes on another aspect. Some people and some scholars call it a mystery form. And I've studied that mystery form, the phraseology mystery form, I can't really figure out. But it's more like an aspect. In the parables of Matthew 13, Jesus describes the kingdom in its mystery form from the time of the kingdom to his ascension and his second coming when it's actually set up. So when you study the Bible and you study these kingdoms and these parables and the mysteries, go to chapter 13 again and look at verse 11. Matthew 13, 11. And he answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you, you disciples, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them, those that didn't want it, but to them it is not given. So you notice the phrase, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. I want you to underline it in your Bible, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. So a mystery in the Bible, especially in the New Testament, is something that is hidden in the Old Testament, but is revealed later, usually later in the New Testament, is revealed. So the kingdom itself was not a mystery. The Old Testament saints knew there was a kingdom coming. They all knew that. So that was not a mystery to them. They knew that the kingdom was coming. And prophecy after prophecy after prophecy in the Old Testament reveals that there would be a kingdom. However, the mystery was this postponement or this delay of the kingdom actually getting set up. So during the absence of the king, the disciples were to preach the gospel of the kingdom. They were to go out and preach the gospel of the kingdom. And as the apostles gathered candidates for that kingdom, there would also be all kinds of wickedness mingled in with these candidates. And so at the end of the world and the harvest, God would sort out the wicked from the righteous at the end of the world. Go to Matthew 13. Matthew 13, verse 39, I believe it is. Yeah, Matthew 13, verse 39. The enemy that sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are angels. So he's talking about something that's going to happen at the end of the world. There's going to be a sorting out here. And the angels are going to come and they're going to gather all these people together, and then Jesus is going to separate the goats from the sheep, and there's going to be a separation there. That's going to happen at the end of the world. Look at verse number 50. And he shall cast them, that is the unrighteous, he cast them into the furnace of fire, and there shall be a wailing and gnashing of teeth. You see that phrase, wailing and gnashing of teeth? You study that in your Bible, that's always a reference to something's going to happen in the end times. He's going to be sorting those out, and then, and those, there's going to be a separation about those that are going to go into the kingdom and those that will not. So to answer the question that the disciples asked, let's go back to chapter 13, verse 10. So the disciples had this question. That's a good question. The disciples came and said unto him, verse 10, why speakest thou unto them in parables? As I said earlier, God is using these parables to reveal the truth to those who are willing to accept it, and to conceal the truth from those who are insincere or who are opposed to the truth. See, here's a principle that you need to understand. A man must follow the light that God provides. And as long as God follows, as long as that man follows the light that God provides, God will give him more light and more light. However, if he rejects that light, then God is under no obligation to give him any more light. He's already rejected the light that he has, therefore he won't have it. The statement is, light rejected becomes lightning. So to know the truth, a man has to have an open heart to receive it and then live by it. He has to have an open heart to receive the truth, and once he receives it, he's going to have to obey it. He's going to have to live by that truth. There's a couple of examples of that. Pastor Wirtz brought a great series on the Wednesday night Bible study on Cornelius. Cornelius is a great example of a man who was open to the truth. And he had enough light, and he was a good man. He prayed, he gave alms, and so forth. So he was a good man. So he was open to the truth. So God then says, okay, I'm going to give him a little more light. So he sends Peter to Cornelius' house, and Peter tells Cornelius how to get saved, and Cornelius gets saved. So there's an example of a man who was following the light that he had, and God gave him more light, and he eventually got saved. Go to Acts chapter 28. Here's another example, only it's the other side, where a person is not open to the truth. And because he's not open to the truth, God blinds him to the truth. Acts chapter 28. Acts 28. Look at verse 25. And when they, that is these Jews that had come to Paul, when they agreed not amongst themselves, they departed. After that, Paul had spoken to them one word. Well spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah, the prophet unto our fathers. He quotes the passage in Isaiah, verse 26, saying, go unto this people and say, hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For the heart of this people is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart, and should be converted, I should heal them. And be it known therefore unto you that salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, and that they will hear it. So basically what he's saying here, he says, you Jews, you've had your chance, and you've not been open to it, you've not received the truth, therefore your eyes become gross, you've been blinded, and I'm going to go now, I'm going to take the gospel to somebody who does want it, who will listen to it, and that's the Gentiles, and they'll get saved. So go back to Matthew 13 again. Hope you're still with me. Chapter 13. So look at verse 11 again. And he answered and said unto them, he's answering the questions, why are you using parables? Because it is given unto you. The you there are the disciples. Because it's given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them, those that aren't open to the truth, those that don't want the truth, but to them it is not given. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that which he hath. Therefore spake I unto them in parables, because they seeing, see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. This is the same one that Paul quotes, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed. See, they didn't want it. Their eyes are closed. Lest at any time I should see, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should be converted, that I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, you disciples, blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. So, basically, the reason why Jesus taught in parables is so those that were open to the truth that the parable was trying to convey, they would accept it. But anybody who heard the parable and they weren't open to the truth, they were already rejected in their heart, God's not obligated to give them any more light. Therefore, their eyes have closed, their ears are dull, and therefore, they don't get any more light. Then another reference for that, let's go to the book of John, chapter 7. Basically, says the same thing, a little bit different words. John, chapter 7. Okay, John chapter 7, look at verse 17. John 7, 17. You ought to have this underlined in your Bible. If any man will do his will, he shall know. Amen? You have to come to God with an open heart, and as he tells you what the truth is, you need to be willing to do that truth. If any man will do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak it of myself. So the question is, are you willing? Do you come to God with an open heart, say, okay, God, speak to me, and whatever you tell me, that I will do. Now, God knows your heart. Don't say to God, okay, whatever you tell me, I will do, and then you have no intention of doing it. God ain't going to show you nothing. God ain't going to show you nothing. So Jesus teaches these seven parables that I already mentioned, these seven parables in Matthew chapter 13. Now go to verse number 51. After he gets done teaching all these parables, he ends up with the parable of the dragnet, and we'll talk about that in a few weeks. Look at verse 50. He says, "And he shall cast them into a furnace of fire, and there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth." Jesus said unto them, "Have you understood all these things?" Now you underline that question. Have you understood all these things? I've given you these seven parables. Now, do you understand what I'm talking about? Now, I don't know. I know what the Bible says. Have you understood all these things? Peter looks over at John. And, yay, Lord. They said that, I mean, they kind of had that look in there, like a calf looking at a new gate, you know. Should I pass through that thing or not? You know, it's like a deer in the headlights kind of expression. They had, I don't know, here. But they finally answer, "Yea, Lord." Or they thought they understood. But did they really understand? I don't think so. I kind of am inclined to doubt it. The reason I say that is because, go to chapter, here in chapter 13, go back to verse 33. And this is the parable of the leaven. And we'll talk about that parable in a few weeks. "Another parable spake he unto them, the kingdom of heaven is like unto" what? "Leaven," underline the word leaven, "which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till the whole was leavened." Now, I'm not going to explain that parable to you right now, but he uses the phrase leaven, and it's talking about a woman kneading this leaven into bread until the whole lump was leavened. Now, go to Matthew 16. Just over a couple of pages, Matthew 16. And look at verse 6. "Then said Jesus unto them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees." So do you see the word leaven there? He says, you better watch out for that kind of leaven, that leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. I'm chapter 16, verse 7. Look out for that. Stay away from that. But the disciples didn't understand it. Go to verse 7. "And they," that is the disciples, "they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we've taken no bread. When Jesus perceived, he said, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves because ye have brought no bread? Do you not understand?" He asked them in chapter 13, "Do you understand all these things?" They said, "Yea, Lord." Well, obviously they didn't understand what the leaven meant. This, and he mentioned in chapter 13, verse 13, this leaven that this woman puts into this lump of bread. So if they didn't understand what Jesus meant by the leaven of the Pharisees, go look at verse 9. "Do you not yet understand, neither remember the five loaves and the 5,000, how many baskets ye took up, and neither the 7 loaves of 4,000, and how many baskets ye took up? How is it that ye do not understand that I spake it not unto you concerning bread, that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees?" Now they're talking about doctrine, false doctrine. And they didn't understand it. So when they said, when Jesus asked, "Do you understand all these things?" And they're kind of, "Yes, Lord." I don't know that they really understood it, because obviously they didn't understand what the leaven meant. Because a few chapters later, when it talks about the leaven of the Pharisees, they didn't understand that. So I ask you then, I'm asking you, you people here at Canyon Springs Baptist, do you understand? Before you answer, do you really understand? See, all these parables, and we're going to talk about them in the services ahead. In all these parables, they all are basically coming down to the one thing. The end of the world, and there's going to be a sorting out at the end of the world. And some are going to be saved, and some are not. So do you understand that one day you will stand before God to give account of your life? The Bible says you are. And do you understand that there is an irrevocable day coming in your future when you're going to give account of everything you've done, everything you said? Now, brother, I want to tell you, I'm talking about the judgment seat of Christ. And that's not going to be a picnic for a lot of people. I'm not looking forward to that day, because when I stand before God and have to give account of everything I've ever done in my life, a lot of it is wood, hay, and stubble. It's going to be burned up. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And only that which remains behind, that gold, silver, precious stones, is what I'm going to get a reward for. So as I'm standing before God, and He is piling all these works that I've done, and I'm looking at, yeah, that's pretty good there. Look at, oh boy, that pile's getting bigger, 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 bigger. And then God says, okay, let's strike a match to that thing and let's see what's left. And I see the smoke and the fire going up, and all up, and all that's left is just some a little bit of wood, hay, a little bit of gold, a little bit of silver, and precious stones. Well, that's what you're going to get a reward for. Not all the other stuff was burnt up. I tell you what, I look at that with fear and trembling. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. It's not going to be a happy day. It's going to be a happy day when you see Christ, but it's not going to be a happy day when you stand and see all that stuff burn up. Your life, listen to me now, your life is only as good. Your life is only as good as how it will end. I want to say that again. Your life is only as good as how it will end. Peter said, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel? What shall the end be? I'm not talking about what now is. Well, I've done a lot of good things now. I've done a lot of good things now. But whoa, wait a minute. What shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of Christ? 1 Peter 4:17. How's it going to end up? See, we can all talk about the good thing. Oh, I've gone to church and I've tithed and I've supported missions and I've served the Lord and I've been a Sunday school teacher. I've sung in the choir. Yeah, that's great. I'm glad you've done that. But how's it all going to end up? What shall the end be? Your life is only as good as how it will end. Have you understood all these things? I'm going to stop there. But there are some things you need to understand if you're going to be saved. Do you understand that you are a sinner? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Do you understand that?
Amen. Yes.
I believe that. You're either a heaven-bound sinner or you're a hell-bound sinner, but you're a sinner. I don't care if you're saved, you're still a sinner. Amen. Okay, I understand that. Okay, do you understand that your sin deserves death? The wages of sin is death. That's what your sin deserves. You deserve to die. Do you understand that? Okay, amen. Yay, Lord. Okay, do you understand that God loves you in spite of your sin?
Amen.
God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Christ didn't die for you. He died for you while you were yet sinners. Thank God for that. Amen. Do you understand that eternal life is a free gift?
Amen.
You can't work for it. You can't earn it. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Do you understand that? Yeah. It's a gift. Yeah. You can't work for it. You work for your wages. But you don't work for a gift, amen. The gift is free. Do you understand that God will save you if you believe on Christ and call upon Him?
Amen.
That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thy heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall, not maybe, shall be saved. Amen.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
You understand that? Here's a real simple one for you. Do you understand that eternal life is a simple matter of whether you have Jesus or whether you don't?
Amen.
1 John 5:12. I love this verse. I use this verse when I'm out soul winning a lot. This verse. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Amen?
Amen.
Every word in that verse is a one-syllable word. You need an uplifted translation for that. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. It's as plain and simple as you got Jesus or you don't. Amen? Well, if you understand those things, hallelujah. you're saved. Now tonight, you come back tonight. And have time to go on tonight, but right now. But tonight we're going to deal with the first parable here. The parable of the sower, verse 3. He spake many parables unto them, and he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And basically you know the parable. Some parable falls by the wayside. The birds come and devour it. Some fall on shallow ground. Doesn't have any root, and it springs up, and it scorches, and the sun scorches it, and some fall among the thorns, and the thorns choke it, and some fall among good ground. There are four sowings there, four sowings of the seed. We're going to talk about what the seed is and who did the sowing in these things. We'll see what we can learn about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven tonight. Hope you'll be back tonight at 6 o'clock. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heads bowed and every eye closed, please. I've tried to be as simple and plain as I could here. But the bottom line is, have you understood these things? Do you understand that salvation is a matter of, do you have Jesus or you don't have Jesus? It's not he that hath been baptized, or he that hath joined the church, or he that done good works, it's he that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Do you have Jesus this morning? Is there one here that would raise your hand right now and say, Pastor, I'm not sure I'm saved. If I was to die right now, I don't know where I'd go. I hope I go to heaven, but I can't say 100% for sure. I wish you'd pray for me, preacher. Would you put your hand up and let me pray for you? Is there one like that? Preacher, pray for me. I'm not sure I'm saved. God bless you, sir. I see that hand. Anyone else? Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure I'm saved, but I'd like to be. Pray for me. Anybody else? Okay, let me talk to you Christians just for a minute. Has God spoken to you about something in your here today? Maybe there's something you need to get right with God. I'm going to ask you to get right today, because you don't know. You might be in eternity before this day is over. You might be in eternity before this day is over. Father, I pray for this one person who raised their hand. I cannot see their heart. I do not know, but let us know whether this person is truly saved. I pray, Father, if they're not saved, that they'll get that thing settled this morning before they leave here. And Lord, for anyone here that you've spoken to about things, maybe some Christian here that needs to get some things right with you, I pray they get right today. And have your will and your way in this invitation, I pray, in Jesus' name. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to stand to your feet. Charlotte's going to play something piano. Just stand to your feet right now, heads are bowed and eyes closed. And if you want to come down to this altar and talk to the Lord about it, or if you just want to deal with these matters that where you sit with your seat, by all means, do what God tells you to do. God tells you to come, you ought to come. Tells you to get some things right, you ought to get some things right. But don't leave this place the same way you came in. Let God have His way. Come on. God speaks to you. Up here at me, please. Amen. God bless you. Appreciate your attention this morning. And now don't forget, October is Pastor Appreciation Month. So drop Brother Wirtz a note. Just tell him how much you appreciate him, how much you love him. Amen. That'll mean a lot to him. And then don't forget to be back tonight at 6 o'clock. We'll continue this series on the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. God bless you. You're dismissed.